Fugacity. It's just one of those thermodynamic properties that sometimes cause headaches. So hopefully the screencast will provide you background on where it came from and why we care about it. So to accomplish this, we're going to start with ideas of chemical potential and reference states. Go back a little bit. First, let's all agree that property relations for mixtures of ideal gases or solutions are important as references in the analysis of real gas mixtures, and this will help form the basis for introducing fugacity. The second thing I want to touch on is that we have known that for two phases of a species to be in equilibrium, in a liquid and a vapor, for instance, the pressure and temperature in both phases must be equal. Hopefully, by now, you have also heard of chemical potential and know that it must also be equal in both phases for each species to be in equilibrium. So we go back in time to an ideal gas mixture. We've seen the PV equals nRT. I'm going to rewrite this just in terms of pressure. I'm going to write this V as V total, the number of moles of species I, designated as NI, would take up the same total volume alone at the same temperature. Now, this will yield a pressure of that species. We've seen this. I'll label this equation 1, this equation 2. If we divide 2 by 1, then we're going to get the pressure of species I over the total pressure of a system, since RT and V will all cancel out. Now, you've hopefully seen this before. We designate that PI as the partial pressure. This is the gas mole fraction times the total pressure. So that partial pressure is the pressure a species would take up if it was alone and didn't have any interactions and behaved ideally. All right, and we know that the sum of all species' partial pressures is the total pressure of the system. To advance, we need to discuss partial molar properties, such as the partial molar volume of species I. I won't go into details here, but it is defined as such. This is going to be a constant pressure, temperature, and keeping other species' moles constant. So this represents the change in molar volume of a species in a mixture to the addition of that species, keeping everything else constant. For instance, now you could try to picture this. This, of course, is an abstract kind of equation, right? But if you think about adding ethanol to an equal molar water ethanol solution, you might assume that the change in volume of the total mixture would just be the volume of the ethanol that's added. This isn't true, because in a real solution, as you see in your lab doing this, interactions between ethanol and water molecules change the partial molar volume of each species, thus affecting the total volume. All right, back on track here. So we could rewrite this as RT over P times change in moles with respect to the change in species I, keeping other moles constant. And in an ideal case, we can just rewrite this as RT over P. So that the partial molar volume in an ideal gas mixture is equal to the pure species molar volume at the same temperature and pressure. We could do this because we're assuming two things. For an ideal gas, they're comprised of imaginary molecules having a volume of zero. And two, there's no interactions. Now, of course, in most systems, neither of these are true. Pretty boring, really, but again, this provides a great reference. And that's something to keep in mind. So, the summary so far: a partial molar quantity, other than volume of a species in an ideal gas mixture, is equal to the molar property of the species as a pure ideal gas at the same mixture temperature, but at a pressure P that's equal to the partial pressure in the mixture. That's pretty much summarizing what we've seen so far. This works with other partial molar and mass properties as long as it's evaluated at the proper pressure, that being the partial pressure. So what does this mean? Well, let's take the case of enthalpy. The enthalpy of a species I in an ideal gas mixture at some temperature and pressure is just going to be the enthalpy of the pure species at a temperature T and pressure PI. For entropy, it's a little different. Same temperature, pressure. This is going to equal the entropy of the ideal gas mixture at a temperature and pressure P, but we're going to subtract out this difference, R times the natural log of YI. And this comes into play because entropy is not independent of pressure. And I won't get into where this comes from. You could look it up in your thermodynamics textbook. So here is where all the mathematical fun happens. So I'm going to try to skip through each part kind of quickly just to save some time. So the Gibbs energy of an ideal gas mixture is defined as the following. Again, I designate all the ideal gas values with the IG property. So the partial Gibbs is going to be very similar. At this point, we could replace everything from these two equations into those equations. So hopefully you see how we got that equation. At this point, you should recognize this as the ideal gas Gibbs energy. So we could say that the partial Gibbs energy is equal to the ideal gas Gibbs energy plus RT natural log of YI. Okay, now this is going to be an important equation to keep in mind as we progress. Now, when you go back and look at your notes on partial Gibbs energies in a mixture, we know that this is also considered to be the chemical potential. And so we will set that equal to the following. And that is an equation that we are going to use heavily as we progress into fugacity. And no, we didn't forget about fugacity. So this is the first equation that we're going to use. The second, if you recall, change in Gibbs is equal to the volume times the change in pressure minus the entropy times the change in temperature. If we assume constant temperature, we could rewrite this for our mixture, and using a substitution for the molar volume, we can plug that back in. Then when we take this equation and integrate it with no boundaries, just using an integration constant, we get the following. This is that integration factor at constant temperature, and every book might use a different symbol. I'll go ahead and use the capital gamma. We can go back to that equation I started before for the chemical potential and see that when we plug everything in, we get the following. We can simplify this further and say that the chemical potential is equal to some integration factor plus RT natural I of YIP, which we know is the partial pressure. And the sum of each of the species is also going to be the Gibbs energy of the mixture, and looks like the following. And so we expect this to describe ideal gas behavior tremendously well, which it does. So, can we start talking about fugacity? I believe you may be ready. So we're going to start with these two equations, since I said before that they were pretty important. And here's the twist. Since Gibbs energy and chemical potential were both defined in relation to the internal energy and entropy of a species, both which are primitive values and absolute quantities can't be measured and are unknown, this means that absolute values of chemical potential do not exist. More so, let's look at this first equation. What happens for mixtures when one species' composition approaches zero, or the pressure of the system approaches zero, such in cases of very high vacuum? Taking the limits, the chemical potential would approach negative infinity. So what's that even mean? I mean, negative infinity. Now, these aren't reasons to scrap chemical potential, but it is a reason to add more quantities to thermodynamics. So we could describe phase and chemical equilibrium easier under all conditions for both pure species and mixtures if we create a parameter called fugacity. So why fugacity, you ask? Well, a little history. Fugacity stems from the Latin root meaning to flee or escape, like fugitive. So think of it as the escaping tendency of a species. Now, you could probably think of a lot of jokes about students' fugacity in class and probably should mention it next opportunity you get, but for here, we'll continue to define it in cases of equilibrium. So we're going to label fugacity as F, and let's substitute fugacity into that second equation for pressure. Now, if you do that for a real gas, the Gibbs energy of each species in the mixture is going to be equal to the following, where I've designated F fugacity of each species. Now, looking at that previous equation, you could probably guess what the units of fugacity are going to be. That's right, they're going to be units of pressure. Now, let's compare the real to ideal, since an ideal case, again, is a nice reference state that we can typically calculate and measure, and a real case makes it a little bit harder. So if we do that and compare this real situation to our ideal situation, we get the following. Now, the left side of this equation should probably look pretty familiar. This is the residual Gibbs free energy. And we have relationships for that that are covered earlier in textbooks. Now, looking at this right side of the equation, we're going to take that term in parentheses and give it a new symbol. So this symbol phi is going to be the fugacity coefficient. So the residual Gibbs equal to the RT natural log of the fugacity coefficient. And the fugacity of an ideal gas is just going to be the pressure. So we know that the residual Gibbs energy in an ideal gas situation is going to be zero, and the fugacity coefficient will just be 1. So I'm going to rewrite that here and kind of rearrange so you see that the natural log of the fugacity coefficient is just going to be equal to the residual Gibbs energy over RT. And this right side hopefully looks fairly familiar. If we go back to how we define the residual Gibbs energy, it was related to the compressibility factor of a species I as such. Hopefully that looks kind of familiar, and we could plug that right side of into the equation so that we can get a relationship for our fugacity coefficient in terms of the compressibility factor, Z. So what does this mean already? Well, we could go to PVT data or a volume explicit equation of state, like some virial equation of state. I'll choose this one where we have the compressibility factor related to a second virial coefficient, this VII. So we can plug that in to our equation and have an integral that looks like the following. So hopefully you can see now kind of where fugacity stemmed from and how we could start using it, because now we have an equation that relates a fugacity coefficient to a second virial coefficient, and we could perform lab experiments to solve for this and get a relationship for that under certain pressures and temperatures. So why we care about this in terms of equilibrium is something I'll touch on kind of quickly. So when we talk about equilibrium, let's start by writing the Gibbs energy of the vapor as such. Now this relates the Gibbs energy of the vapor of species I to a fugacity of that species in the vapor phase. We could do the same thing for the liquid so that we use the fugacity of species I in the liquid phase. Now if we do the same thing that we did before relating these two Gibbs energies and subtract them like such, we're left with the following. So we know that if we have vapor-liquid equilibrium, this quantity on the left is going to be equal to 0. And if that's equal to 0 at some temperature and pressure, and this is going to be the saturation pressure, we know that the fugacity of the species in the vapor phase must be the fugacity of the species in the liquid phase. So we'll call this the fugacity saturation for species I. So now we kind of have a new rule to go upon such that for a pure species coexisting as liquid and vapor, if they're to be in equilibrium, then the temperature, the pressure, and the fugacity in both phases must be the same. And we could also say that the fugacity coefficient saturation is just going to be related to the fugacity saturation over the saturation pressure, and this is going to be equal to the liquid phase and the vapor phase. And again, this is all at vapor-liquid equilibrium. So we care because we want to know if a system is at equilibrium, and this is one way to determine that, among other things. The fugacity sort of acts as a correction factor for pressure in real systems, and we've seen that relationship compared to the ideal cases. So let's look at two quick estimates of fugacities. First, we could look at how to calculate the fugacity of a compressed liquid. Now I'll go back to this relationship between the fugacity coefficient and the compressibility factor Z that I showed you before. We're going to evaluate this at a pressure at saturation, so Psat. And so we know that the fugacity coefficient in the vapor phase is going to be the fugacity coefficient at saturation. Then we could also use the relationship that the fugacity at saturation for species I is going to be the fugacity coefficient at saturation times the saturation pressure. All right, so this reference would be for the saturated liquid. We calculate the fugacity change from the pressure increase since we are compressing the liquid. So we're going from Psat to P, or some pressure P, as we go from a saturated liquid to a compressed liquid. So this is relating that change from the saturation conditions, our new values. And so we look at that left side, and that left side is that residual that we have seen before, and we know that that's equal to RT times the natural log of the fugacity over the saturation fugacity. And if we substitute this in, we have the following equality. Since the molar volume in the liquid phase, the VI over here, is a very weak function of pressure, as long as the temperature's under the critical temperature, we could assume that the molar volume in the liquid phase is just the molar volume of the pure species, and that's a value that we could look up. And so this now becomes the following. And all I've done is integrate that right side from the Psat to P. P. And if we use this relationship that I showed you before for the saturation fugacity and substitute in the following, we'll get a relationship to calculate the fugacity. And all I've done now is rearrange a little bit and have fugacity equal the fugacity coefficient of saturation times the saturation pressure times this exponential. And this exponential on the right side is known as the pointing exponential. And so pretty much everything there you could look up or know from what you're trying to figure out. Fugacity coefficient, saturation, you could look up in tables such and so forth for the saturation pressures. So hopefully this gives you an idea how to calculate the fugacity in the liquid phase for a compressed liquid. The gas states just depend on the equation of state that you use. So if you decide to model your real system using Ping-Robinson or Lee Kessler or the SRK, etc., you just substitute that back in at the beginning and kind of go through the calculations. So at least you hopefully know where to insert those, and I'll leave that for your own exercise. And again, remember that we care about this because at equilibrium, the fugacity in the liquid phase is going to equal the fugacity of the vapor phase. So we could determine specific parameters of our real system if we know how our other phases are behaving.